Amen. We give honor.
Thank you.
We give honor today to this house.
Your brother,
blood brother, spiritual brother, your pastor, Pastor Donald Miller. Amen. And First Lady, Lenora Miller. Oh, you may be seated. Pastor Redwood, Reverend Solomon, and Reverend Abel. These deacons, these ministry, deaconesses, ushers, and this choir, amen. Thank all of you, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, this morning. I bet this evening, amen. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. I was telling Minister Thornton, he came over, my youth minister came over this morning in the uniform. Amen. I was letting him know, I said, boy, let me tell you something. Before he came, I pulled him aside. So, boy, let me tell you something. You don't realize it, but you're walking in my shoes. I say I was the first youth minister at that church. And you going over there, so you better make sure you do a good job. Because the foundation is already laid. Amen. I say now, I was there when it, you know, it first was born. Amen. The youth ministry. And it's a great thing to see it still going on. Amen. Amen. And y'all doing a wonderful job over here with them too. Amen. I told them this. I want these ministers to know today. This way I did my first sermon right here. Amen. My first sermon. I remember when Brother Brian came to New Macedonia. I remember when Sister Jones had to make Brother Jones come to church. And she had made him come. But you know what? Look at him now. Amen. Amen. He ought to reach over there and give a kiss right now. But amen. And then they say God work in mysterious ways. Amen. Amen. I got a lot of memories. Amen. Of this house. Amen. A lot of memories here. But I never thought, as they would say, in a million years, that I'll be here doing an ordination service for ministers of this house. Amen. Amen. I never thought that. And Brother Jones, I was thinking, I believe this history because I was licensed here, but these are the first ministers that came under this ministry under Pastor Donald Miller that were ordained here. Am I correct? Amen. And I'm happy to be the one to do it. Amen. Somebody else supposed to do it now. Somebody else supposed to do it, but I'm the one doing it today. Amen. And we thank God and give God glory for that. And we're honored to be here. But from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1. First Corinthians chapter 1. And I'm reading from the NIV verse. We have that same man. I'm going to start at verse number 20. First Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demanded signs and Greeks looked for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human man, human wisdom. And the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom for God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. You may be seated. I want to talk, as I tag this subject today, when nobodies become somebodies in the kingdom of God. When nobody becomes somebody in the kingdom of God. When Jesus began to look for his apostles, his disciples, the ones who would first of all preach Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. When Jesus began to look for someone, he did not go to Yale University and sit down at the graduation and see who get their doctor's degree. He didn't go to Florida State or any other universities, but he went down to the Fish Creek.
All right.
He went down to the pond, and he found somebody by the name of Peter, Andrew, John, and James. He went down where other folk wouldn't go. He didn't go to the church where all, you know, the philosophers was, who had their doctor's degrees all over the wall because they were somebody. But he came and he knocked on Brother Jones' heart. He knocked on Brother Brown's heart just when they thought they weren't usable. God came to let them know, I want to use you. Have you ever been in a situation when you thought you wasn't good for nothing? You thought nobody would ever love you, nobody would ever pick you on the team. You know how it was when you was little and you was always the one they picked on, the one they didn't want to choose to play in the basketball game. You know, you was always seemed to be the sorry one, the lazy one, the one nobody want to give attention to. You know, you was the one that everybody always pushed aside, talked about. You know, you the one, the black sheep, as they were calling in the family, when nobody always look at you, but they will go around you. You was like David, you know. You had to be the one always where the stinky sheep was, not in the front where the brother was, the lowly, you know, the one nobody wanted to deal with. But I'm glad God, he ain't like us. I'm glad God does not look at your resume, and if your resume don't look right, you know, if you ain't got the right degree on your resume, but you might have the right talents. You might can do the job, Sister Amy, better than anybody could do it, but you ain't got a doctor's degree, a bachelor's degree, a master's degree. You ain't handling all the paperwork, but you got the Holy Spirit. You got the power of God. You got something working on the inside of you. You got something more than other folk don't have, but you never thought nobody was used you. God, he goes by the fish creek. He goes by the fish creek, but not only does he go by the fish creek, but he likes to go by where people hate us, you know. Haters that hate you, they don't love you, they don't hope you never be anything. They hate you. That's why he stops by the tax collectors. He talked by and he picks up Matthew. He picks up Matthew and thought he was a good choice, that Matthew would be one of his disciples who would become one of his apostles. Nobody else would pick Matthew. Nobody else would pick Peter. Nobody else would pick Jones. You know, nobody else would pick Brown. But God saw something in them. Nobody else would see them. You know, but God liked to go by the jailhouse. You know, he liked to go by the ghetto. You know, God, as a matter of fact, Jesus is a ghetto person because he come from Nazareth. He come from the ghetto. He didn't come from Hollywood Hills. He didn't come from Hollywood on the beach side. No, he come from Nazareth, man. He comes from the ghetto. The ghetto was the place where you ain't going to pick nobody out to lead nobody. It's the place where you don't look for no leaders. God does not look for leaders in a university. He don't mind getting you out of the ghetto and taking you to a university. But no, because sometimes wise folk, you can't tell them that because they're already too wise. See, but they have no understanding of what they're going through. So God don't want to deal with it, but he can't stop by Macedonia and say, y'all thought y'all was just coming to church one day. It was like me, I just was coming to church. I wasn't coming to be no deacon. I wasn't coming to be no, as a matter of fact, when I was little, this is what I told God, because somebody had told me, say, look, the more you know about God, the more is required of you, and you're going to have to give an account. So when I was young, I used to walk down the street, and I didn't know at that time I was praying, but I was talking to God, and I told God, let me tell you something, God, I don't want to know nothing else about you. What I know about you now is enough for me. And in return, I did not know that the Lord was telling me right then, I already choose you, because see, you right in the place where I can use you. You got to be in the place where you can use you. When nobody becomes somebody in the kingdom of God, first thing we have to see the position that God don't require. God does not require prestige. See, you think that you got to have it all together to be a man or a woman of God. You think you got to have prestige. You got to be sitting in the doctor's seat. Everybody calling you somebody because you somebody. You sitting up high. You think you somebody. Everybody, you know, speaking to you. But stay right there where you are. I guarantee if you stay right there where you are, nobody ain't got to say nothing to you. Ain't nobody got to wave their hand at you. But that important person come in, they don't mean you no good. They don't care nothing about you. But you can't wait to get in front of them to show them your hand. God don't care nothing about your the prestige, nor does he care about your predicate. He don't care about that. He don't care about your position. He don't care who you are. He don't care what your name is. Don't care what titles you got in the front of your name, because you think you somebody don't really mean you are somebody. I know a whole lot of doctors and who got degrees, a whole lot of master's degrees. They just as stupid as anybody else I ever seen in my life. They just got the degree. They ain't got no common sense, but they got a lot of knowledge, but they don't have wisdom because they don't know how to apply what they already know. It ain't about your prestige, your pedigree, but no, it is about, watch this here. He said, neither those that are noble. In other words, if you ain't got to be in the place where I come from a well-to-do family and I'm next in line like the royal family, you know, then what they got come from the royal family to be the next in line for king or queen. You don't have to come from the noble fair place. You know, you ain't got to be born with a silver spoon in your hand. You already got it going on together. You know you're going to go to the best school. You're driving a car before you even get a license. And you ain't got to come from there. God don't care about that stuff right there. But no, God don't care about that. Ain't God requirement. Some folks think I'm going to have to have it all together before, you know, God chooses me. That's what I like about black folk. We know we, you know, God calls us. Yes. I know some folk go to school so they can do this job. Yes. They go to school, in other words, they go to school so this can actually be their occupation. But this is a job you got to be called to do. Because see, this job right here, because if you go to school, ain't nothing wrong with going to school, I ain't stay there, stay with me now. But what I'm saying, there's some folk hadn't been called to do this. They went to school, man, and you know, they put in their degree, their pedigree and stuff like, you know, and said, this the job I want. Oh, but when the rubber hit the road, when the hair started flying, they could quit and get out there and leave the congregation alone. Because they weren't called to do it. Watch why. Some folk can get up from this job right here and they can just say, I'm gonna leave it the heck alone. Yeah. But when you're called to do this thing right here, there is some folk that God do call. Yeah. The people that God does not reject. Here they are. They are feeble people. First of all, they're foolish people, you know. They don't have, you know, the stuff everybody else got. You know what I mean? They just believe in what the word of God says. They foolish people, you know. They believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They believe ain't nobody got to convince them, knock them over the head. They believe this. He says, this thing, look at here, the foolishness of preaching. They're talking about those who believe in Christ, those who don't have to be so convinced. Now you got to convince me. Now you got to show me. God, let a star drop right here before I believe anything. No, I believe he died. He got up from the grave, rose with all power in his hand. He get those that other folk don't want. He go by the junkyard. You know, junkyards are there for a reason. Some people go by the junkyard to get parts for their car because they're smart and know that I can go to the junkyard and save money and get the same part I can buy brand new. And some folk go because they ain't got the money and the Lord open the door where they can get the same thing at the junkyard that they can get, you know what I mean, at the Lord store new. So God knows what's in the junkyard just as good as it is what's on the car lot. But watch this here. But what's in the junkyard ain't junk when it get in God's hand. See, you got to see. When this thing get in God's hand, it turns to be a whole different thing. So he does. He don't reject the foolish, nor does he reject the feeble or the weak. You know, some folk don't want to deal with you because they figure you can't handle some things, you know. They figure you can't keep up, you know, with what's going on. They figure you're going to drop out the race. They need somebody who's going to be strong like them. They need somebody who's going to be there with them. No, they figure you're too weak for the deal. But they got to realize one thing. You are in God's hand. And so you got to understand, when God chooses you, can't nobody take that away from you. But you got to understand, whether you get high the pastor one day or not, if God puts you there, you ain't got to worry about nothing, my brother. You ain't got to worry because I don't care what folk do to you, you're going to be able to handle it. I don't care what you go through, you're going to be able to handle it. But if you get high for something that you haven't been called to do, you'll quit anytime. So he comes and he says, God take the base things of this world. You never thought he'd call you. God will come because you got to realize I know a whole lot of brothers who own crack cocaine, who smoke dope, but now they're leading people because God called them. A whole lot of folks who know they weren't worthy to stand in the shoes of John, but yet they stand with tears in their eyes because they know they weren't worthy of what God has done for them. And because God has done it, they can't change it and nobody else could. So they know they come for it. You ain't got to remind them you used to be a crack addict. As a matter of fact, when you come by the church, all you see on the churches is a bunch of exes anyhow. You ex somebody, and some of us got a whole lot of exes on our name. As a matter of fact, can I just throw this out right here and say, your degrees is full of exes. Yeah, put that degree on the wall. the exes is that you could get, look, you got a testimony, which means you went through enough hell in your life that you can tell somebody, if it had not been for the Lord who brought me up and out of what I was in, I wouldn't be able to do what I do. He comes, he gets the foolish, he gets the low, he gets those that obeys, you know what I mean? So you can't come and boast about anything when you get up here and when God begins, you know what I mean, to give you wisdom and revelation of a word you could not read, but only you could get from God. And that's when you can sit and say, and while we hear some preachers say, thank you, Holy Ghost, because God has just dropped something in their spirit that they couldn't even read, they couldn't get from nobody else. Why? Because they was called to do this thing. And when you're called to do this thing, God goes down where nobody else is going, huh? He goes over here, you'll go, but Jones, you'll do 20-something years, and then yet folk thank you. Look at here, you are exodus, they'll think you is this Brother Brown. They'll think you have never been nobody. They'll never been talk about you. You know, you're the least in the family. Nobody will listen to you anyway. But you always praying. You foolish man. What's wrong? God ain't hearing you. Look at him. He's stupid. That ain't good, you know. But God, he was looking at you. But God, he knew your heart. Every time you were smoke, God knew your heart. Every time you snuck, God knew your heart. Every time you knew the hill, you sold dope, God knew your heart. Because God knew something was on the inside there that he could use. See, you might have looked at big on the outside when you were doing it. Oh, but you wasn't nothing but a little turtle on the inside. And God knew that you wasn't but a little kid. Because that time when you had to go and God had to pat your back, God had said, God, if you could help me ever get out of this, I give you my whole heart. And God, when I give you my whole heart, I give you my whole life. See, some folk too big to tell God if you get me out of it. Some folk think they got enough money to pay their way out. Some folk think they got enough strength to fight their way out. Oh, but honey, you ain't got enough nothing when you come to God. Because when God sees you, he sees you at a zero. And that's why when God sees you as a zero, he the one makes you a hero. Here he is. God, I'm almost finished. God will take a zero and make it a hero. How do you do it? Sister Agin, this is how he does it. I look at this thing and I'm better than God. How do you make these zero brothers out of a hero? God said, what I do, I put a one in front of them and I make them a 10. In other words, when I put a one in the front of them, I make them 10 times better than they was when I met them. And God said, then what I do is, when I get another zero, I make it 100. So now I make them 100 times better than they was. And then when I keep on multiplying that thing, it's like I'm 10,000. God said, I take a zero and can make it 10,000 better than the world. I can take another zero and make it 100,000 better than the world. Ain't nobody do it like the Lord. When you know that you got the Lord on your side, God got a bunch of zeros in the church. Oh, when God gets you in his hands, he makes you better than you was. He makes you bigger than you was. But you never forget where you come from. Don't you ever forget where you was. Don't you ever forget who picked you up. I don't care how much pedigree you get now. I don't care how good it gets. I don't care what people talk about, hey, reverence. Don't you let reverence get to your head. Don't you remember that God, the one put you right there. Folk didn't call you, God called you. Don't you let folk know you're, tell you all, you just like him. You can marry now, you can marry now. You can get your own church, start your own ministry, lead them by. If God didn't tell you to do it, you better stay humble, baby. You better stay where he called you. If God don't lift you up, you stay right where you at. Don't folk won't whisper in your ears. Don't folk talk to you by something. Brother, you can do that. Brother, you can write to me. You don't really need to go there. Go preach everywhere. You can evangelize where you want to now, because you a reverend. You still under the leadership of Reverend Donald Miller. You still under the leadership. Because anybody who been called by God, there's always a chain of command. See, when I was in the military, there was a chain of command. You know, the president, the four-star general, on down to the private. And in all instances, some of them be younger than you. Because you're older than folk. You hear what I'm telling you? Because because they're younger than you, you teaching what we respected, it was what was on the collar then. And when you respect what's on the collar, then you respect the person. So what you respect is the position the person got, and you respect the person. Because you know who called the person and put him in that position. You never got bigger than your daddy, am I right about it? You might have got older, but you ain't never got bigger than your daddy. And if your daddy was like my daddy, let me tell you, you ain't gonna tell my daddy you gonna knock him out. But boy, you never get too big for me to knock you out. And that's what God, you never get too big for God to knock you out. Because when you look back where you come from, you got to remember who brought you, where you come from. And when you remember who brought you, you can look at Jesus and say, he come from the ghetto. He was in Nazareth, but I come to preach Christ, his crucifixion, his death, burial, and resurrection. I come to let somebody know that Jesus lives in your place tomorrow. I come to let somebody know he's no longer in the grave, but the third day morning, he got up out the grave, and he got all power. It just give me more preachers to call when I get home. Because I know these brothers going to do the right thing. Because they come from under Pastor Don New. And from the New Macedonian Baptist Church. So I know they're going to do the right thing. So now you get ready after the day to walk out. You're still a minister, but you're a reverend now. Some folks be like jumping and hollering, but Mr. Jones said somewhere, we was questioning, you got to look at what comes behind it. A whole lot of responsibility come behind reverend. It ain't just being a reverend. It's the responsibilities. Now, when Pastor Donald Miller is gone, one of these brothers in charge, that means that you're accountable for these sheep while he's gone. All the accountability lay on his shoulder. So what you do affects him. So how he handles it gonna affect him. So it ain't no easy task, y'all. What I'm trying to say, you got to pray more for the brothers than you ever prayed before. Because they got a great responsibility. Come up, give God a hand clap of praise. God bless you. Understand. Maybe someone is out of the ark of God's safety, and I offer Christ to you now and pray that you will come. The Bible said that. He says, come all of you that are labored and heavy laden, for learn of me, I'm meek and lowly in heart, and I'll give unto you rest. For my yoke is easy, that burden shall be made light. So you may come by letter, Christian Experience, a candidate for water baptism. Bible says, for now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. He said, when you hear my voice, harden not your heart, for I came to my own, and my own received me not. But he said, for as many as received him, he gave them power, gave them the right to become the children of God. Maybe you strayed away. He said, if you just come back to me, I'll come back unto you. That's a good God. He said, I am the door. I'm just waiting to come into something. God got the best program
that you can ever be on. He got a way that man can't get over, man can't get around, man can't get other, but he said you must come to the door. He said he's not going to open it up. He said if you open it up, I'm going to let you in. That's a good God, y'all. He said whosoever will, to let him come. Weary, wounded, and sad, I declare you'll find in him a resting place, and he will make your soul glad. I'm a living witness. He picked me up, turned me around, planted my feet on the solid ground. I came to Jesus just as I was. Gin and juice, everything else. But God gave me a new cup. Cup of the Lord. And often as I drink of this cup, I do show the Lord's death till he comes. Can't nobody do it like Jesus. God can fix you up. He said he'll do it daily. It's not an overnight thing. And he'll fix you up. He said, let your light shine so men will see your good works, and then you'll be able to glorify the Father which is in heaven. He said, do you know that I am the vine and you're only the branches? Those branches that don't bear fruit, he said, I'll cut it off for you. But those that bear fruit, he said, I'll purge it for you. A whole lot of stuff had to fall off. There's some good stuff on this street now. Somebody want to say amen? And God can do it. He can do that power. He got the power to do all things but free. I heard him talk about the junkyard. Things that seem to be impossible with man is possible with the Lord. You're never beyond repair. God know how to patch you up, break into pieces. He can take two fish and five bottle loads of bread and feed 5,000. He can take our problems. Somebody say this mission is not impossible. Come on, y'all, help me. This mission is not impossible. God can do all things but fail. God bless you. Change. Y'all don't have to get up. We're going to the ushers to get the baskets and take them down row by row. Amen. And give as the Lord has given unto you. Amen. Somebody say it's offering time.
Offering time.